Well, hello again. I'm Keith Cherney. I'm publisher of the Valley Courier, and I'm so glad to see such a crowd here since you could be sitting at home watching a boring vice presidential debate. I think we've had enough of that already, but there's plenty more to come, unfortunately. Just a reminder, some housekeeping. If you've got a cell phone on you, please make sure it's in the silent mode so we don't have any interruptions with our and respect for our candidates tonight. Again, I want to welcome you on behalf of the Valley Courier and the Alamosa County Chamber of Commerce. I'm joined by Randy Wright, the Executive Director of the Chamber. We co-sponsored this event, as well as one we did earlier at the Bridge for just the commissioner candidates. Just so you know what the format is, we're going to start the first hour here with the commissioner candidates, and then we'll move into the statewide candidates after a 10 to 15 minute break. There are some refreshments that Society Hall, our gracious hosts, have to offer in the back, and the Courier and the Chamber did buy some meat and cheese trays. I didn't tell you that, Randy, but it's on me. So, starting this early and probably not going to finish up till about 9:15, if you need a snack, help yourself. And by the way, support Society Hall. This is a beautiful facility for our community. They are trying to raise money for a better sound system, and anything you can do to help them out with donations, they've got tip jars on the bars, help them out. I did want to remind, before I introduce commissioner candidates, all of you voters, you have the opportunity to vote for both of these races. The county commission is not, I mean, even though there are two districts represented here, everybody gets to vote for everybody. So keep that in mind. If you live in the city or in the county, it doesn't matter. You still get a vote in both races. And if I'm wrong about that, somebody correct me. I just wanted to make one comment, because this time of year especially, and particularly our presidential candidates remind me of this every day. I was at the El Pomar Foundation's annual meeting in Blackhawk the last 2 days, and Judge Dennis Mays from Pueblo was at my table all day yesterday, and he made a comment that just made me really think, and it was about grant giving and what we do with the El Pomar Foundation. But I thought, wow, that fits the election as well. And what he called it was analysis paralysis. You know, we get to that point where we're analyzing everything, and all of a sudden we're paralyzed. So don't overanalyze. Make a decision based on your conscience and who you think will represent us the best. So I would like to introduce our, I think I'll introduce all the candidates before we move on to the drawing for the order. On my right, your left, we have Darius Allen, George Wilkinson. On my left, your right, we've got Helen Sigmund and Steve Atencio. And let's see, I'm trying to remember districts. I thought I had that in my notes and I don't. You're three, okay. And you're one, all right. Let's, Randy, draw for who gets to make their opening. The format will be they'll get 5 minutes to make opening comments. Randy will signal them at the 4 minute mark so that they know that they're down to 1 minute. And then in the question period, they'll get 3 minutes, and Randy again will signal them at the 2 minute mark. Okay. Who was second? Okay. Alrighty. Well, without further ado, Steve, you get to make opening comments. You do have a mic at the table. You're welcome to use this one if you'd rather, but or you can stay seated and speak from there.
Thank you. Well, as far as my background, I think there's been some newspaper articles and information out there, and I don't want to dwell on that, but I can tell you that I am a very fortunate beneficiary of an excellent education, culminating in obtaining a law degree from Stanford Law School. Since graduating, I've been a practicing attorney for over 33 years, and I think my legal experience has allowed me to develop skills and knowledge that will help me serve Alamosa County as a county commissioner. For those who are concerned that an attorney will be a commissioner or two attorneys will be a commissioner, please rest assured that I have no intention of being a county attorney. I plan on being a county commissioner, not a county attorney. I will not be providing the county with legal advice, but I will be a commissioner who understands the law and can read bills and can provide opinions on things like that and be knowledgeable in terms of what the county attorney should be looking at. So I plan on working with the county attorney to address the county's needs, not to supplant the county attorney. One of the needs that the county has is to fully utilize and protect water rights. And I believe I am uniquely qualified of these candidates, of all the candidates, because I've been a practicing water attorney for over 30 years. As far as local water matters, I was involved in all legal proceedings regarding subdistrict number one, excuse me, which included two trials in the water court and two times up to the Supreme Court. The second time I argued it personally. So I believe I am uniquely qualified to assist the county in navigating the upcoming rules and regulations. I don't know anyone else that understands water among the candidates as much as I do. My opponent recognizes the importance of water, but I actually don't recall any involvement in water matters. I think it's one thing to talk about how important water is, but it's an entirely different thing to understand water law and have the knowledge and abilities to navigate both the legal and political systems that engulf water rights. I do have some experience in developing and operating business. I had a successful private legal practice for 25 years. My wife and I, we had a very successful title insurance company for a decade. And we have also been involved in developing a subdivision. So we're familiar with business. I recognize the needs of businessmen and farmers and ranchers. I've worked with them, I've represented them, and I think that would serve me as well as a county commissioner. I've also served as a county attorney. For the last 16 years, I've served Canoas County as their county attorney. So it's allowed me to become familiar with county government and some of the issues that are facing all of the counties in the valley. As far as county government, I truly believe that county government should be run like a business. I think the old ways of doing business need to change. We have to face tough times with smart, honest leadership and not succumb to decision making based on politics. I think the citizens of this county deserve a commissioner who is open to fresh ideas and is willing to work on new results. I believe the business of the county should be open and transparent. There should be no reason why our local citizenry find out about pay raises through good investigative reporting. That's something that should be open and transparent. We should have those discussions on where those monies are coming from and whether it makes sense to dip into the community development fund to pay for those salaries. I understand the job of county commissioners to be a steward of the county's resources, but I also think the job of a county commissioner is to provide real leadership, to look for new ways to do business and help the citizens of the county. Thank you.
Helen, we'll go to you. Thank you.
I want to thank Keith and Randy, the chamber, and the paper for organizing this. Our citizens must be involved in elections, and it's so good to see all of you out here today. I always worry that We have such low voter turnout throughout our nation, and we need to be involved. I know some of you go to county commissioner meetings, and some of you go to city council meetings, and I always applaud those people that want to be involved and want to know what's going on in their government. We all need to be involved in that. I came here 34 years ago. See, Sunday will be our 34th anniversary. Jim and I got married and decided where to live, Alamosa or Washington, D.C. Now, I know what everyone would say today, right? I don't think anyone's mentioned it, but it's National Taco Day today. So these are the important things, no. But I always wanted to live in a small town, and I was so happy that I had that opportunity to come here and raise two children with my husband, Jim. I've practiced law here for 34 years. I agree with Steve that we aren't trying to be elected as county attorney, but rather we do have the analytical skills and are able to ask some of the right questions and look into things. I took over for Mary Ann Dunn's spot as county commissioner in August after she died in July, and it's a bittersweet time, but I have learned so much about the county and all the work that Mary Ann did for her term in office. She really reached out to all of the members in our county, and that's what I think is important, that we all be involved and we all feel that we are involved in our county business. There's so much that we have here, so many resources that we can draw upon, and so many great individuals. When you think of the Rio Grande Farm Park and how that developed and the people involved in that, you think about the Boys and Girls Club and their project, the IT classes that they want to get. There's so many people here, and we just do need to get together and solve some of our problems together. So I am trying to reach out and listen to people. I've been going door to door to meet people. And there's so many things that we can do here. I want to continue to have Alamosa be a place that we can all be proud of. So when I talk a little bit about my background, I have always had an interest in people. I started out as a teacher, and I've lived overseas, and I've always wanted to talk to people and meet people, and I think that's so important to reach out. That's part of leadership too, is to listen to everyone, get ideas from everyone, and really incorporate those ideas to move forward together. We have a community here that can work together. One thing I think that we really need to do as a county is to work together more closely with the city of Alamosa. I'm really hoping that we can do some projects together because we're stronger together. So I hope that we can learn some things tonight and hear some different ideas. We do have problems that are facing our county today. We have an overcrowded jail. Everyone's heard about that. That was one thing that Mary Ann was very strong about, going around to all the different community meetings, raising awareness of the problems there and getting the 1 cent tax passed. We now are the beneficiaries of that 1 cent tax, and we can use some of that money to address the problems at the jail, the overcrowding there. Mary Ann was also very involved in the public health committee. I've just taken her place on that. The Sangre de Cristo National Heritage Area and the senior citizens. So we had our last forum at the bridge, and it was very interesting to see how concerned those seniors are still. They're so concerned about our democracy and their needs and being able to reach medical services. So we really have a lot of problems and a lot of things that we can do, and we need to do them together. So hopefully you will vote for me in November, and actually you can vote in October because the mail ballots will be coming out in October 17th, and so it's on to Darius.
Right? Thank you. And actually, I think the ballots are being mailed on the 17th, and we should see them in our mailboxes between the 18th and 20th, somewhere in there. And thank you, Ellen, for reminding me that it's National Taco Day. I was going to bring tacos, but that would have been a mess, so we didn't do that. So, Darris, you are up.
Been back down. There we go. Keith, thank you for the time and effort you put into this, and also thank Society Hall for opening up the doors to us, and every one of you folks that came out tonight and took the time and effort to be here, I think it's very important. Just a little background on myself. I started here in the valley as a horseshoer, moved here in 1977. We've been here a little over almost 40 years. And my wife and I, we've been married 42 years. My wife retired from teaching school, and she put in nearly 25 years as a school teacher. I'm still an active farmer and rancher, and I'm proud of that, and I continue want to do that. I enjoy it so much. But, you know, I look at my background, and I applaud my opponent here graduating from Stanford. I applaud you for that, Steve. That's great. That's a great accomplishment. It wasn't my choice in life that I wasn't able to attend that, but I did attend a little better school than that, if you can believe that. It's called the School of Hard Knocks. On a day-to-day basis, I ran an insurance agency for 20 years. And with that insurance agency, I had several employees. I had an office in La Jara, I had one here in Alamosa. 95% of my clients, farm and ranch business. And so I'm proud to say that I was involved in the farm and ranch and agriculture, not only here in Alamosa County, but in the San Luis Valley. And I've always said that anytime you think about farming and ranching, it's not only the backbone of Alamosa County, it's not only the backbone of the valley, but it's also the backbone of the state of Colorado. It's also the backbone of the United States of America. Is feeding the people of this country, and I'm proud of that. And I still want to continue doing that. Going back to my family, I have a son who happens to be here tonight, Blue Allen, and he runs a successful business out south of town. He trains horses, he trains rain cow horses, and I've got my grandson with me here too, smiling real big. It's always good to see them. I have two daughters, both of them are nurses. One daughter lives in Castle Rock, she's an RN. She's a graduate from Pueblo, which is now CSU Pueblo. And I have another daughter who's an RN, graduated from right here at Adams State College. All of my children went to school right here at Alamosa. All of them participated in sports. All of them participated in education factor right here. And I'm proud of that, too, that their roots are here in Alamosa, Colorado. Like I said before, we've been here nearly 40 years. Moved here in June of 1977. And it's always easy to remember that date because that's just my son turned 1 year old the day we moved here, so it's easy to remember that. Everything I say tonight, I just want everybody to know that it wasn't Darris Allen doing this on his own. We have a terrific staff with Alamosa County. We have some of the top-notch department heads that anybody can ask for. We have some of the top-notch elected officials we can ask for in the state of Colorado. And I can say that with proof behind me because we have counties and county commissioners that come here to this county on a regular basis and they ask me, how did you guys do this? How did you guys do that? Walk me through this. Just 2 weeks ago, we had a young lady here who's a commissioner in Virginia, King George County, Virginia. She was working on putting in a solar farm in her little county there. A small solar farm, 10 megawatts. She found us on the internet and wanted to know how to do it. She flew out here, spent 3 days, you know, showed her exactly how we walked through that, step by step by step. And on the other hand, what was nice about that, she's working on a big broadband factor right there in King George County, Virginia. Shared some fantastic information which only will help us here in the valley. You know, I mentioned the valley a lot because what happens in the valley somehow or another comes back and it benefits Alamosa County. We're the recipient of that. I serve on a lot of boards, and a lot of times I don't serve on them just because Alamosa. I serve on them because it's for the whole valley, and once again, anything that happens in this valley comes back to benefit Alamosa County, and I'm going to continue that. We've got some fantastic things we're working on, some capital projects. We passed the one-cent sales tax. to build a new judicial building, and also included in that to upgrade our detention center, which has needed it for years. We've tried for years and years and years to be able to come up with the money to do that. Now we're going to be able to do that and do what is correct and what is right, not only for our county, but for the sheriff's department who works over there and our employees of that sheriff's department. But just looking around and see everybody that's here tonight, I just wish we really could have had to have this thing at Plaquey Hall. But it's nice to see everybody here. I appreciate you being here, and looking forward to visit with each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Darius. George.
Thanks, Keith. I want to thank the Society Hall and Randy and Keith for setting this up tonight, and everybody for showing up. You know, it's that time of year again, or, you know, about every 2 years it comes around that we have to elect somebody. And last time I got beat by Mary Ann Dunn, and at that time I was elected or honored as a Commissioner of the Year for 2012, 64 counties in the state, and I was the Commissioner of the Year for that year for the county, and that represented all 64 counties. And also, a little bit of my background is I worked for the CDOT for 39 years, and I was in management and leadership for over 30, and I was in charge of everything east and south of Alamosa, and at times I was in charge of the whole district. I had 1,200 lane miles and over 108 employees we worked with. I was in supervisory skills for 30 years, and I partnered with the city, and we worked several things with the city, and we partnered with them on the different projects that we had between the two of us. We partnered with the rest of the counties in the San Luis Valley. Just like Darius said, we're not just here for Alamosa County. It was Rio Grande County and Sawatch and Mineral, and everything that happens in them counties is a direct impact on us. I also represent the seven counties in the transportation planning region. I'm the chairman of that, and I represent them on staff in Denver once a month. And we work to improve our infrastructure and building our highways. The four-lane highway west of town here, we worked on that, Charlotte Wobisky, and a bunch of us got together, and we hammered them on that for about 12 years or better to get that done. And Highway 17, where they widened the shoulders, we did that. The repaving jobs that we've done all over the valley, that was part of the TPR planning. And then we have a signal light coming in over here at the junction of 17 and 160. And that's going to be a great help for the truckers and people that sit over there for a half an hour trying to get out on the highway. And we're working to increase the passing lanes between here and Fort Garland, and the passing lanes between here and Monta Vista and South Fork. And, you know, in the summertime, it's tough to get around anybody if you are traveling on the highway. And other than that, I've been married for 53 years. My wife's in the audience tonight, Karen. I have two children, Matt, he works at Town and Country, and Amanda, she's at the Alamosa State Bank. And so we've been raised here. I've lived here all my life. And when working with the highway department, I was to work to improve the highways and to look out for the infrastructure and look out for the county and try to improve them to where when you're going down the road, we ain't hitting a chuck hole or we bouncing off the road. And I was your commissioner from 2004 to 2012, and I have the experience, the knowledge, and the leadership, and I would like for you to consider me for your vote in the mail-in ballots and the election that comes in November. So think of me, and I have the experience. We don't have to go out and look for it.
Thank you, Georgia. Don't get too comfortable, because I'm going to reverse the order for the first question. And I wanted to, again, apologize to the audience that we just did not have enough time to be able to take questions from the audience. Randy and I worked on these based on what we think the issues are. And hopefully you're going to get a better picture of who you want to cast your vote for. So question number one for all the candidates, starting with George. What are the three most important issues facing Alamosa County? And what is your vision for the future, both in general and in terms of infrastructure?
Well, I think I've already covered the infrastructure. I think, you know, we have broadband. We need to look at that and try to get better service of that in the community, economic development. And without the infrastructure, we have no economic development. And I think the first thing we could do with economic development is spend our money at home. You know, we bring these local car dealers, or the car dealers from Durango over here, and they sell 42 cars to people here in the valley. They turn around and take their money back to Durango. And we have the car dealers in the valley, whether it's here or whether it's in Center or Monta Vista or wherever, and this is no different than any business we have, that pay taxes, they support laborers, and they support our community. The people that come in from someplace else and sell cars and do everything else, they take their money and go back to Durango. So I think that would be the main concern of economic development, is spend your money locally instead of taking it out of town. And I think that would be the biggest charge that the valley would have. Our transportation, I covered that. Senior citizens. And, you know, it's hard to narrow this down to just three items. There's senior citizens, and then we have the solar projects, and without the transmission lines, we're kind of at a stalemate on that. When we were commissioners together with Mike and Darius, we came up with a 1041 plan, and that regulated all the solar that went into the valley, and that's where we came up with the community development fund. And that has benefited the nonprofits and the other organizations around that we had to, you know, help with their finances. Do I get 3 minutes or just?
I got one more.
Oh, okay. And anyway, our senior citizens, we fund that through we did, and I think they still do, through the nonprofits. We furnish their fuels for their vans and their vehicles that they run around with all the time. And so that's a big benefit for them. And we do, and then if they're in a shortfall between the city and the state or the county, we come up with more money to help them bail themselves out. So I think that, we're looking at the seniors and the infrastructure and the economic development, and I think that, you know, like I say, the best thing we can do is look around our community and our businesses here and work on that. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Darius.
That's a loaded question for sure. If I had to pick out three, I'd say the three biggest concerns I have is health and human services, probably employment issues, and probably along with that is always water. Water's our lifeblood here. We've always said that, and it is. So let's go back to health and human services. When you're spending $6 million a year on food stamps in Alamosa County only, that gets your attention in a hurry. You know, we got a problem. I serve on the Health and Human Services Child Welfare Committee. We delegate where $372 million goes across the state of Colorado every year. Our social service, our Health and Human Services program, is half of our budget. We got a $34 million budget. About $16 million goes to Health and Human Services. And I've told them, and we've talked about this at our meetings all over, is that one thing that really gets my attention and really is discouraging to me, it seems like we keep throwing more money at the problem. We need more caseworkers, we need more employees, we need more of this, more of that. But I think what it boils down to is, right, where these kids are coming from. They think the normal anymore is to grow up in a family with drugs, alcohol, fighting, domestic violence, sex. All those kind of things are becoming normal for them, so we need to change that, and we're working on that. The second thing I said was growth and also jobs. And I just, real quick, like off the top of my mind today, I was thinking about the different jobs that's been created, and I think the small business person are the ones where we need to look for jobs. Just in the last couple of years, agritourism is really starting to take off, and I think that's just set for us right here in the valley. We have so much agriculture. The San Luis Valley Malting Company, right out in Waverly, Colorado, they support six families out there now and what they're doing. The mushroom farm, back up and going, 125 people working there. They're getting ready to expand that to another 100 people. I met with a delegation from China that came in, looked at all their equipment, getting ready to update that equipment where they can take advantage of that, hire another 125 people. And those are new dollars coming in. When we look at the new infrastructure that we need, we got new airlines coming in with Boutique Air. I think that's going to be a great asset to us. And just the sand dunes road out there, we're working on that. We're in the short list for a grant we applied for, that $3.4 million to resurface that and also have enough room there for a bike lane. So we're on the short list for that too. And we talk about all those things, tourism ties in so strong right here. The tourism is brand new dollars coming in that we can use, take advantage of, and depend on that industry coming in. Because the great thing, and I've always said this, they come in, they enjoy things, they take pictures, they spend money, and they go home. Wouldn't it be wonderful for your company to do that at times? But there's just so many things that we got cooking right now, and I wish we had more time to tell you more and more and more, but we got them both. Give me a call.
Thank you, Darius. Helen.
Yes, I think the three most important issues facing our county today are the overcrowded jail, the opioid epidemic here, and economic development. Now, with regard to the overcrowded jail, again, Marianne was just instrumental in getting that tax passed, and we are in the process now of meeting with architects, and we're finding that all of the estimates are greater than what was presented to the public when you voted for that tax. So we're going to need to really be hyper-vigilant in making sure that we stay within our budget and yet make the jail safe and accommodate the extra people that we need to accommodate there. So much of our budget, it's a bleeding budget that goes into taking care of these inmates that we have to ship out to other places. We are also working on the pretrial release program with RMOMS, that's Rocky Mountain Offender Development Corporation, to see if we can have some people released on either an ankle monitor or some kind of other system so that we don't have to have them in the jail taking up that space. We had a meeting, Steve had arranged this meeting the other day with some of Dr. Troy, who is working on treating the drug problem here. She's the only doctor here in the valley that's working on that. She has a methadone clinic that has spaces, and she has Suboxone for pregnant women, having success with that. The pregnant women in the jail, and the county ends up being responsible for their medical expenses. So this is a real drain on our budget, and we need to address this problem. And so when you talk to Sheriff Jackson, he's quite open in saying 90% of our inmates have drug-related problems. And you look at drug-related problems, and I think drugs maybe touches most of us here in some way or another. And we know that drugs are not necessarily a criminal offense, but rather it's a disease. And we need treatment for these people. And so we get people in the jail, they're clean in the jail, and then they're released. And yet there's this time span, because we don't have the resources to make sure that when they get out of jail, even if they have a bed to go to in a treatment center, they don't go there right away because someone's not meeting them at the door, taking them right there. So then they're back and have another problem. We need to get together with behavioral health, with our physicians, and kind of really brainstorm some ways that we can address some of these drug problems here in the valley. we can't look at roads as our only infrastructure here. Economic development requires a good infrastructure. We have a deal where we do have boutique airlines coming in, but they're coming in at the 11th hour. We've lost our EAS funding, so we need to come up with a better plan. We've just started with a new airport manager this week, and I'm glad that we have him on board because there's so many issues facing our airport in terms of bringing it into compliance. Things kind of have been left and kind of failing. I agree with Darius that we have great people working for the county, but we have resources that have been stretched too thin. So we need to come up with some ideas and work together in solving these problems. In economic development, I agree with Darius that tourism is important, including agricultural tourism. But I think tourism can also lead to people wanting to be here. And you come here, you see it. Hey, there's recreational opportunities. We have a beautiful national park. Trails, people are working on trails along the river. We have so much energy in the valley, but we've got to really capitalize it on it and turn it into something positive. I'm concerned when we aren't putting...
Oh, we're out of time. I'm sorry.
I thought I was...
No, it's three minutes on the questions.
Oh, well,
thank you. That's
our,
yeah, well, it was five on opening comments and three on the questions. So, Steve.
Thank you. I believe the three most important issues that we face, number one, the opioid epidemic, number two, law enforcement and the jail, and number three is our lack of economic development. My vision for the future generally and in terms of infrastructure, number one, my vision for the future involves focusing on people instead of building more buildings. We have an incredible staff, but we have trouble retaining them because we don't have competitive wages. We need to focus on those people that do the work, 250 employees, and provide for those folks and the local citizens instead of building more buildings. With regard to the opioid epidemic, as Helen said, we've already been discussing some things that we think could help the community because it's very much affecting the community. I'm sure you've spoken with business people that say, hey, I've got jobs that I can't fill, and I think I have great applicants until it's time for a drug test. The social services provide some help, but it's the tip of the iceberg, and we need a commissioner that's willing to recognize it and address it straight on. I've been working the last 2.5 years in Conejos County for social services, and I have been on the front lines of the drug war, the opioid epidemic, and we need to take it on and resolve that as best we can. My vision for the future involves a positive relationship with the sheriff. There has not been, I think, a positive relationship, and we need to address the jail. The jail didn't get to this situation overnight. It's been developing for decades. And we need to address it because it is a terrible situation. We have to focus on infrastructure in that regard as well, because I think we need some treatment facilities. We need halfway houses. We need other ways of dealing with the opioid epidemic instead of putting them in jail. And we can work with our local community providers that are out there, such as Dr. Troy, the Mental Health Center, Community Corrections. There's a number of things that we can do. As far as infrastructure, I'd love to see a batch plant. Why did we sell the batch plant and then start buying asphalt? Okay, that would be helpful. Broadband would be helpful. I'm envisioning an Alamosa County solar farm, okay? I envision a future where we break the stalemate, the apparent stalemate, on a second transmission line. I've already been speaking with folks locally who have great ideas, and we can do that. We can put in a second transmission line, open up solar development, and I'm done. Thank you. I'd love to speak with you more about it. I've got a lot of ideas.
Mm.
Thank you, Steve. We're just trying to stay on task here to get some subjects covered. And you've all touched on, pardon me, some of the questions that I had prepared. So I'm going to just kind of jump around here a little bit. You've all touched a little bit on economic development, but I think I'd like to hear specifically, how do you plan to help the county improve the local economy? And I'm going to mix up the order here, and Darris will go to you.
I think there's lots of ways that we can and we have been, and I mentioned just a few of them, and some of the businesses that we've supported. I mentioned the Houghton Waverly, the little malting company out there, and how many letters of support and how many phone calls we set out and made for those people to continue to open up that business and do that business. Another new business that's going on out there is a pelleting. Teddy Harrison is just starting this pelleting of alfalfa pellets right out there in the Waverly area. He's already got three people working for him. I don't know how many letters of support we've written for him, how many phone calls we made. We can help with those. That's one of the ways we can do it. People coming up with an idea, they can come to us. I still believe in a free enterprise system. I don't think it's up to government to be the ones to step in there and create and look for jobs. But if somebody comes to me with an idea, I'll say, hey, I'll help you. I'll sit down and say, where do we need to go? And some of the other things, unmanned aircraft. We heard about this 2 years ago. I took a trip to Denver and I listened to them. I thought it was something we could be interested in. They came down, we spent time together, and we created something where we control the airspace right here in the valley. So talked to those folks just last week, and we talked about what we could do as far as moving forward. One company out of Italy that's been here two times to talk to us and look at the places we have, they love it here. We got exactly what they want. We got the elevation, we got the mountains they can fly in, it's flat, we have a lot of population out where they want to fly, just everything is working for them. So they've already got 50 of these things sold, so they're interested in trying to figure out how they're going to build a plant. So we're on top of that too. So all those things take people who in the government who will step up the plate and support those ideals that they have. We had the baseball parks that come in. We stepped up and supported those. I think all these things are things we need to support. And it just goes on and on. And I'm all for economic development. What we got to do is create and put our arms around what fits our needs here. Other communities around the state, they put millions of dollars in a line item just for economic development to go after companies. We don't have that luxury here, but we need to take advantage of what we do have. We got the clean air, we got the outdoors, we got the agriculture. So let's look around and see what we can take advantage as far as those.
Thank you. Steve, we'll go to you.
Thank you, Keith. First and foremost, I will be a champion of economic development. It's sad for me to hear. I've spoken to two different people that have gone to my opponent with people interested in starting businesses, and were told Alamosa County is not in the business of economic development. Okay, it's time that we are, and it's time to put money where our mouth is. I was shocked to find out that the county only provides $1,000 per year to the Alamosa County Economic Development Corporation. That is not supporting economic development. We need to provide more support for Marketing Tourism Board, for Alamosa Chamber of Commerce, and have a commissioner in the lead that wants to promote economic development. I believe that involves, and it's required to involve, the university, the college, and even the high schools, so that we can get our local partners involved in that. Look at what ASU Community Partnership is doing. Wonderful things. They're an incubator of business, and we need to support things like that, so, as well as the seed park. We need to promote and develop the broadband. We need to bring in that second transmission line. And we need to enhance solar power. Right now, it appears that we're at a stalemate. I want to break that stalemate and get solar power here in the valley developing again and expanding, and that includes having an Alamosa County solar park. We've got the land, it's next to the transmission, we've got that kind of experience. I've been involved with the solar development as well. I was local counsel for Sun Edison, at the time the largest solar production facility in North America. We have to break that stalemate and bring that kind of business here. And not just say, oh, welcome drones. I love it. Drones are great. I've gone to Denver and done the class as well. I'm familiar with the rules. But take it a step further. Involve the drone industry with the university and get some classes going. Get some entrepreneurs developed, some engineers. Have them involved at the college. Have them involved at the high school. And exact a toll. If we're going to reduce the fees to attract the industry, get something from it. For example, at least once a quarter, if not once a month, open up your facility to the youngsters that are interested in drones and use those little powerful thumbs that they've developed and learn something about a new industry, develop a dream, become an entrepreneur. There's many things that we can do, but it has to start with leadership and a willingness to promote economic development. And I will provide that.
Yes, Helen, you're next.
I definitely agree with Steve on working with the university in this regard. I happened to talk to Donna Weehee today about the origins of the Alamosa County Economic Development Committee. And Dr. Fulkerson, who was our college president years ago, was the one to have that idea. I've had conversations with Dr. McClure about working more closely with the business department. I know a lot of businesses here in town could benefit from partnering with some students, and it's a symbiotic relationship where they could benefit from getting some work experience, and the businesses could get some benefit from having their insight and new ideas that are coming in. So it is a matter of working together, and we do need to fund some of these projects, but we also need to make sure everyone's not duplicating each other's work. We need to have more joint efforts in this regard. Developing our trails, the Boys and Girls Center starting an IT class, all those things are going to help us develop. And jobs are critical for our economic development. One of our problems here is that we don't have a lot of jobs for people, and so we do need to work on getting businesses to come in here and finding out what we have. Broadband's basic to that. So is our airport service. So is some other transportation that we can have to help not only our seniors get to medical appointments, but people get around, because the valley is a huge area. And I think we do need to think of some of these things as a valley. We have right now an opportunity to work with marketing and developing a brand for our valley to make this a place that people want to come and do things. I know our county administrator is on different committees to partner with the university and agricultural jobs. I just went to a lecture from the at the university on hemp. That's a great opportunity for us to build on an agricultural and natural one, and a product that uses less water. So there's so many ideas, and people are really ready to seize on some of these, but we do need to work together, and there does need to be leadership in that regard. So I'll make sure I don't go over my time this time.
Thank you for giving back 30 seconds anyway. So, George.
Okay, I want to start off by saying, you know, we do live in a great place. Whether you believe these people or not, there's not a lot of changes that, you know, that we could stand up and do. We've had good leadership in the past with our county commissioners. It isn't that everybody's just went out there and sit down and let things slide by, because if you look around the things that have happened in our community to enhance economic development and to bring things into our valley. And you know, we have the water plant up here on the county line and different things like that. And we do support the Chamber of Commerce and the sand dunes. That's one of our biggest tourist attractions. And we are trying to get that paved to where it alleviates the pressure on 150 and brings people into Hooper and Mosca and enhances that community a little bit. But, you know, it all takes time. You can always sit on the side of a football game and tell them how to run it. But I think in the past, our commissioners have done a decent job. And that's all I got to say.
All right, thank you, George. I think we're going to limit this to one more question, and I know several of you have touched on this, but I think it's a huge problem, not just here in the Valley, but statewide and nationally, if not internationally. How should the county handle crowding at the local jail? And related, what should be done about the epidemic problem with drugs, namely opiates, painkillers, and heroin? And let's reverse the order, and we will start with George.
I think we ought to get together and pass a 1 cent sales tax. Oh, we did that. You know, and that, you know, that's supposed to alleviate part of the problem we got at the county and the Justice Center and the jail. And if we get our extra 80 beds there, it takes time to get this stuff done. We've been working on this for several years. It isn't just something that came up last night. But we have been working on this. And if we get the jail and the architect picked, I think that's a process. I'm not involved in it right now. But we have got the 1 cent sales tax passed. And that was the step we needed. It was the money. It don't grow on trees around here. I've been looking, and I think everybody else has, but we haven't found one. But we do have the resources now, and we are generating, I think, more than what they said was going to be generated on this 1 cent sales tax. So that is going to help us considerably. And I think that we get that, and the jail will be to where it's livable, maybe. You know, and if you don't like it, don't get in there. And that was always, you know, that's what my folks always told me. If you don't want to go to jail, stay out of it. Yeah. But we have got that under control. We got to give it time to start working. I mean, it don't happen overnight. We can't start laying bricks tomorrow without a plan. So they're picking the architect. They're doing that. And we do have a fabulous community here. The people that live here, the people that work here, the people that travel through here, and the every town we associate with here has got, that's coming to Alamosa and do their shopping. They're an asset to everybody. And we need to appreciate the people we have here. Thank you.
All right, Helen, would you follow, please?
Yes, we are working. We do have an architect. We are working on the jail, but the jail was originally built, I think, when my husband and I first got here 34 years ago, for 46 people, and today we have 130 inmates, so they're everywhere. And we're going to add, so what they've done is doubled up, and the jail now can hold about 87 people. And what they're planning to do, what we're planning to do, is add about 64 beds. And we know that that's not going to be enough unless we start doing something to help the drug problem and address some of the problems. We have to be forward thinking. We really have to address some of these problems as a community and work together with not only behavioral health, but with Dr. Troy and drug treatment programs to really address some of the underlying causes for what the crimes. And so many, as I said earlier, Sheriff Jackson says that 90% of his inmates are drug related. So we need to be thinking and address some problems at the root rather than just letting them grow and grow and grow. I am concerned that the jail has taken. I mean, it's been a problem that's continued for a long time. I know that Charlotte was on the Board of County Commissioners when they had an opportunity to expand the jail some 20 years ago, and should have been addressed at that point in time. So we do need to look forward. Now, with regard to drug treatment, education is important. I was concerned when we met and I heard Chief of police say that the schools weren't willing to do drug education with the law enforcement. We need to start a dialogue and get everybody at the table and address these problems, because school is going to be an important place for kids to learn about drugs and how to avoid them and all the problems that they results in. And I agree, the jail's a horrible place. I was there. I took a tour. And it is. It's terrible. But that doesn't mean that we don't have an obligation to the inmates to have it be a safe place. Sheriff Jackson, I think, has aged tremendously over this last couple of years that he's been in office and dealing with this problem. It's, we've got to address it. And yes, the 1 cent sales tax was passed, but that doesn't mean that we don't still need to look at this and solve some of these problems. I know we're starting neighborhood watch groups again. We need to work as a community. I'm glad to live here, but we need to keep working together and make it a better place.
Steve, sorry, I lost track.
Thank you. The drug problem's not going away. We've got to address it. We've got to take it head on. And you need leadership at the county level that recognizes it's a problem throughout the country. I think as a commissioner, number one job is to go after the money that's available at the federal level to address the problem. How do you address it? I think education, prevention, treatment, enforcement, and long-term planning. We have to start education and prevention at the lowest levels of school. The youngest levels of students have to get in there and do those programs and make sure they understand that heroin is not a character flaw. Heroin addiction is a serious medical issue that involves changing brain chemistry. Okay, you're not going to beat it on a 12-step in the most part. Some might, but you need treatment. Most of them need inpatient treatment. The rest of them, we've got great treatment facilities at mental health, at Crossroads. We have to get more money to do that. We need to get more doctors involved with the drug-assisted treatment, such as Suboxone and Methadone. And we need to get money to law enforcement so that they can address the supply that's coming into the communities. We have to do that, okay? And all we hear is lamenting about, oh, it costs money and it's gonna take a lot of money, but people, we need to do something to help law enforcement. 24 or 28 vehicles are over 10 years old. Before Sheriff Jackson, the patrol officers had to pay out of their own pocket to maintain their vehicles. At this time, Sheriff Jackson's only gotten enough money to supply half of the firearms for our law enforcement, okay? We need to have more post-certification. Let's start a scholarship, okay? Let's start a fund. I bet you I could go around and get a couple bucks from each one of you to do a fund so that we can provide our law enforcement with ammunition to train with, and all have the same kind of ammunition, okay? We need to address the jail. It's not right. It's inappropriate to make jokes about this. It is a serious situation, and it's a true testament to Sheriff Jackson that we haven't had problems there. That jail is falling apart, it's overcrowded, and the 1 cent sales tax is not going to solve the problem. We need to go out there and get the money so that we can have treatment facilities, whether they're low security, high security, or have treatment facilities for folks that aren't criminals. Because I'm telling you right now, what you're seeing as the heroin epidemic, if you look at only what social services is addressing, it's the tip of the iceberg, okay? Just as we all know, functional alcoholics, we have a community of functional heroin addicts that we have to address. And you need the leadership at the top to do that.
Thank you, Steve, and Darris will wrap up with you.
I don't know if I like the way you said that, wrap up with me. Thank you, Keith. Talk about the overcrowding of our detention facility. I think we've reached a point where we got the money to continue with that, we're looking to put $8 million approximately in that right now, increase it by 64 beds, bring it up to code where it needs to be. And what we don't realize, or what sometimes we forget to think about, is when it was built for 48 inmates, it was built for 48 inmates for the type of heating, the type of cooling, the type of airflow and ventilation in there. It wasn't built for 130 inmates. So we're dealing with that, and we have been dealing with it. I've given a third of my life to this county as a commissioner. And when I first started, that's one of the things we talked about. And the numbers kind of went up, they go down, they go up and down. But they're to the point now where they're up there and they're staying up there. And we worked really hard to go to the public and say, hey, this is what we need to do. We need a judicial building. Statutory, we are required to provide adequate space for them. And statutory, we're required to provide a detention center for inmates. That's what we did. We went to the public. We put on presentations for a long time, lots and lots and lots of them made, and had an opportunity for people to understand what we were faced with. And the people understood it and they voted for it. So I think that is on the rebound right now. If you look at the drug epidemic, not only here in the Alamosa County, the San Luis Valley, but this is happening all across the state of Colorado. We got commissioner friends in Otero County, Los Alamos County. We got friends over in Huerfano County. It just goes on and on and on. So it's not only here, they're saddled with the same thing. What we've done is put together a little task force to communicate with those people at our Southern District Conference that we have with all the Southern District counties in the state of Colorado. We talk about these issues, what we're going to do. We talked about a drug task force right here in the valley. Talked to Sheriff Jackson about it. I think we've had the best working relationship with the sheriff in the last 2 years we've had for a long time. We've stuck our neck out. We've upgraded the vehicles. We've done lots of good things for the sheriff's department. We want to continue to do good things. I think it's important that we do that. So it's not something we look at on and we just take for granted. We're working at it really, really hard to make sure that we make some positive moves in the right direction. But I think we have some money set aside right now. It's in the budget. You can look in the sheriff's budget. There's about $130,000 in there a year that goes for treatment. And so I know we're starting to get a dent in some of that, but it's not going to stop. And I just think we just need to continue working with law enforcement. We continue with the plans we have, and we're working with the architects real hard, like we talked about earlier. And we're going to make this thing work for us. And we're going to have a nice looking facility when it's done, too. Thank you.
Thank you, Darris. Well, we're going to take a short break here, but I did want to just say that I think we're very fortunate in that we have really four strong candidates. I can't say the same for president, but really four strong candidates there for commissioner. And let's give them another round of applause.